it was brutal work. In one case, the guy got his finger chopped up. I mean, I've seen a lot of ugly situations. I've seen someone go, a human being go crazy, actually have a breakdown, chase the foreman, chase them with a hammer. And someone had to restrain him. He went nuts. I've seen men actually destroyed on the belt. And I didn't find any sense of the nobility of labor. I wanted to get out. Mm-hmm. I couldn't. I was trapped. I had the sense that it was a very unfair world. I knew my roots. I was struggling. Came from the working class. I had to work at very low pay. I struggled with that. As far as socialism went, I felt I tripped over it. Back in the late 50s, I came to a bookstore. Ross Dowson was running the bookstore. Of course, I met him and talked, and I was a member of the CCF, but the socialism and reading Marx and Communist Manifesto, that was a development that happened. I had no romantic view of the working class. The working class is composed of many things. Mm-hmm. Purdy was never a member. He was always on the periphery. His heart was in the right place, whereas Acorn was in the movement. For Milton, I mean, he was a believer, and he actually wrote about working people, fishing. That's all wonderful. You know, it was also a romantic poet, more or less a victim of tough love. He wrote about people. That's what he wrote about. Purdy took himself very seriously. He wanted me to write a book the way he wrote about people and issues. And I simply wrote about bees. He really felt he could change society by writing poems that workers would like, or people would like. A group of poets from some from the Bohemian Embassy, which was an after-hours club, decided to hold poetry readings in the park. Well, we started off in Queen's Park, nothing happened. We enjoyed ourselves. We read our poems. Then we went to Allan Gardens, went there to read. And then we discovered we couldn't read on Sunday. Preachers could read. We were in the news. We were reading, and then they prevented us from reading. And then the news got out, and there were hundreds. Then there were thousands of people there. Well, bylaw was changed before you could even get a permit. It just prevented you. But the press generally supported our rights. Even the reactionary Telegram, you know, It's a very basic issue of free speech. I think that an artist has to remain faithful to his or her art form and expressing a view, whether it's in images or what. The poetry's going to have a life force. It has to come from the street. When there's a social upheaval, the poets come in. I'd say it's great poetry, but there's an actual use for poetry because it goes to the core of humankind. It goes to the sublime and brings out the feeling. It comes to the surface. If the poetry can't come from the street level, what use is it? Revolutions have produced poets. And every crisis has produced a poet. And poets have come to the fore in every revolution. Because when there's a crisis, it becomes a spiritual crisis, not just a political crisis. And you can't isolate them both. You know, look at it from the artist's point of view.
Yeah.
Grants don't necessarily mean that the writing is better.
Mm.
Perhaps mediocrity is attracted to money that's readily available.
Mm.
But isn't it nice to know that there is a branch government that actually addresses the issue of culture to begin with, and the necessity of culture. Cultural nationalism, you see, in the early 60s came to the surface. We have writers in this country. We have our own history. It's one thing to understand that, but to get caught in the jingoism of that kind of nationalism, now the reverse has happened. Nationalism is no more, it's globalization. So, puff, the magic dragon, it goes. I think we do. I mean, they're the antennae of society. They show what is. They write what is. So, yes, we do need them. Having said that, I've yet to go to a ballet, you know, or an opera. I want to get into the psyche of humankind because there's such a thing as where humanity can go mad. The lunatic muse, madness, poetry, you know, what capitalism does to the brain.